My name is Louis, and today we'll be talking about metaprogramming, obviously. Now, this talk is a bit different from the talks I usually do, in that it is truly, you know, for a novice audience. Now, I know that we are in C++ now, so, you know, it's not really possible to have such an audience, but still, the goal, you know, is to explain metaprogramming from first principles as much as possible. And the only thing that I will rely on is that you have a working knowledge of C++ 11 and 14. And where I use some slightly newer features, I will try to introduce them, you know, decently. And yes, I would like to apologize for my voice. I hope you can stand it for 90 minutes. I've been having a couple of troubles with my health lately, so. Okay, so we will be talking about metaprogramming, and why do we need a talk for dummies? Is it because metaprogramming is something that's really, really inherently hard and difficult and, you know, opaque, or is it because metaprogramming has always been taught in a very opaque manner? Well, for those that know me a bit, they will know that obviously my opinion is that it has been taught in an opaque manner. I think metaprogramming has been very difficult and very, you know, it is only being used by few experts right now, and the main reason is because the only way that we have to do computations at compile time is to use the template system and, you know, a bunch of dirty tricks to achieve it. And obviously this is not accessible to everybody. But so I think it is possible to teach it in a more accessible manner, and this talk is really my first attempt to teach it in an accessible manner. So I will try, you know, do my best to teach it in a way that even beginners could eventually understand it. But of course, for those that already know about metaprogramming, please forget what you know about C++ 03, you know, previous metaprogramming, because that will be actually, it will really help you to take something out of this talk. Okay, so since we'll be talking about metaprogramming, I believe it is important to justify why we actually need it, because otherwise we won't lose, you know, 90 minutes just talking about something that's not useful. Example I have is generating JSON. I expect that most people in this room have at some point or another, you know, any other format, doesn't matter really. So the goal here, given a user-defined struct, I would like to write generates a JSON string representing my user-defined struct. It's pretty simple. So this should output something like name, colon, Joe, and then age, colon, 30, in braces, and yeah. So this is the goal. Now, in Python, we could write something like this. Okay? What I'm doing here is quite simple, and I know this is not actually generating valid JSON. I'm only you know, considering objects, not sequences, but bear with me. The idea here is that in Python, objects are basically dictionaries. They're basically maps. So the members of an object are the keys of that map, and, you know, the values of these members are the values of that map. And so I can just loop over these keys, which are the members, or the member names rather, then just, you know, fetch the associated value and serialize it and so on. So nothing really impressive here, and it just works. In C++, it's not possible to do that because we have no way of iterating over the members of a struct. We have no way of, programmatic interface to our objects, to our types. It's not possible to do that. Now, this is not only about, like, this example has two special things to it. First, it's what we call reflection. It's some kind of metaprogramming where you are basically looking at the structure of a type itself and possibly, well, you know, reading it or possibly modifying it. Here we're just really looking at the structure of the object. So this is something called reflection. And the other thing that I would like to bring your attention to is that in our computation here, the input is something that is known only at runtime, right? Because this object here could be, you know, the name could be read, you know, from std::in or std::cn, and the output is also something that's known at runtime. The JSON string that is generated is only something that's known at runtime. Okay, just keep this in mind because my other examples will differ on that point. And so I will not be talking about reflection, even though I know it is a very useful thing, and I know it is a cool topic to be talking about. Unfortunately, as of C++ 14, we do not really have a good, you know, definitive answer to reflection in C++. So I will not be talking about reflection in this talk. This is an introduction talk, and I will focus on different kind of metaprogramming things. Now, another kind of, you know, thing that you might want to do where metaprogramming could be useful is registering classes. So let's say you have a list, you know, you have a bunch of classes defined in your file, and when your program starts, you would like to register them. Simple enough. Now, I will place a very annoying and kind of, you know, pointless requirement. It's pointless for now, but it will be useful in, you know, illustrating something else later. This requirement is that you cannot so when you register a type, if its size is larger than some, you know, magic value, which really doesn't matter, you want a static assert at compiler. So, like, is anybody not familiar with static assert? Okay, so basically this is like assert, except your compiler spits in your face instead of, you know, throwing in, not throwing, but rather failing at runtime. It's the compiler that's going to, you know, smash you. The idea here is that, like, so, okay, you want to register types, and it is required that the size of these types is under some limit, and that check must be done at compile time. And so, you know, for the justification for that could be that simply that, like, you know that if you're going to place these an instance, like a singleton, an instance of the of each type in some storage, and you know that you don't have more than, say, 1K in that place, and you know your application will blow at you know, insanely at runtime if you do that. So you just want to catch the mistake at compile time. That's completely, you know, that would be possible. So you want to register classes, simple enough. Now, how would you allow registering many classes at once? So the classical solution would be to use variadic templates and some kind of recursive dense. So what I'm doing here, just variadic templates. Basically, variadic templates allow you to have any number from 0 to, you know, any finite number of template parameters. And so what I do here is that I consider the case where I'm registering no types at all. Okay, I do this by specialization right now. So I specialize my register struct here, and I'm using a struct, by the way, because I cannot partially specialize functions, but it's just like a C++ thing. So I partially specialize my register struct here, and when there are no types, if you're trying to register no types at all, I do nothing, which is obvious. This is the base case. And then the kind of recursive case, even though this is not actually recursion, but it looks a lot like it. So if you give me one type T and zero or more type T's, then I'm going to do the registration logic for this, the T that you gave me, and then I'm going to register the rest of them, you know, kind of recursively. Is everybody kind of clear with what it's doing? So then you can call it using, you know, register ABC, and then it will, you know, get into this specialization here with T being A and T is dot 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 being BC. It's gonna do this code here for A and then call register underscore for B and C. It's gonna go back into this operator parens, do it again until there are no more, until it calls register underscore nothing. Then it goes into that specialization and does nothing. So it's finished. Yes?
Just as a question, could you have pushed that into a constructor? So the registration work into a constructor, and so the syntax, the register, you have curly brackets and then parentheses, which just seems awkward. Could it have been pushed into another constructor, so I didn't have to sort of call the operator paren, but just have all the registration work be done in construction?
Okay, so the question is, would it be possible to push the registration to the constructor so that we do not have to call curly braces to, you know, default construct the object and then call it using operator parens? Yes, I could have defined the default constructor instead of that, and I would just have to create it, you know, a dummy object. It's true, I didn't think of it. Frankly, I think the operator parens thing is makes it more obvious what we're doing, but it's really just a.
So it's basically an empty template list. Could you have made the base case just taking just a single T? Or is it like a technique to say it's better to always go to exhaust your template list?
So the question is, the base case, could the base case be with a single T instead of, you know, no T's at all? Yes, it could. It's really just that I wrote it that way. Although obviously, if you try to register no types at all, then it would give you a compiler error because it would say, like, well, you didn't define what it meant to register nothing at all. Yes?
You would have also ended up with duplicated code, I believe. If you implemented the one case, if you will, then you would have had to.
Oh, that's right. That's right. But I could have called that one. So the comment is that if I had implemented, you know, the register with a single T, the base case as the single T, I would end up with duplicate code because I would need to do this logic here in this base case too. But then I could call this base case from. But anyway, this is all. This actually is all, you know, my point. This is not straightforward. We can understand it. We're like, you know, C++ engineers. We can understand it. But we don't necessarily want to understand that kind of code, and or have to understand that kind of code, and it's not reusable in a very precise way. When I say not reusable, I mean that we're actually doing two things here. One is the registration, and the other one is the looping over a set of types or a list of types, whatever. Okay, what we really want conceptually is a for each on types, you know, and then just, you know, the body of your for loop is just this instead of this ugly thing. So it's not reusable in the sense that I kind of, you know, intertwine my logic with my for loop, and it's not optimal. Now in Python, you can write this. The reason being that types are objects in Python; they are first class citizens. You can just take types, classes here, and just stick them into lists, and then, you know, use all the facilities of the language that you have to work on integers or strings or normal, you know, sane things. Well, you can also apply them to types when it makes sense. Now, what we would like to write in C++ is something along the lines of this, which obviously doesn't make sense. So I create a vector, because that's C++'s kind of list, and I initialize it with my types. Obviously, that doesn't make sense because of the way, you know, the language is. It just doesn't make sense, right? But bear with me. So I create a list of types, and then I, you know, range base 4 over my types, and then I'm super happy. I mean, that's kind of, I'm sure everybody here understands what this is doing. It's pretty simple. Okay, so this is a second example of something that we might want to do where metaprogramming could come in handy. And I would like to draw your attention on the fact that here it is, you know, it is slightly different from the previous example in that the input is known at compile time because my types are known at compile time, yet the output is known at runtime because the registration could have, you know, side effects, it could read from a file, it could do whatever it wants, I don't care. But so the input is known at compile time, yet the output is known at runtime. Or actually, it's like the output is partly runtime and partly compile time because of the static assert here. Another example. Let's say I wanted to optimize the alignment. So I have a triple. It could be, you know, four upple, a tuple, for those that know what this is. And so, but let's say I have a triple, and I have some types, and I want to optimize the you know, find the triple. Basically, I want to find, you know, in which order should I put A, B, and C in my triple in order for, you know, the struct to have the smallest size. Now, it's possible to, basically, it's possible to, the struct that has the smallest size will be the one where the members are in decreasing order of alignment. And so how would we figure out what type is that? Well, what we would like to write is something along the lines of this. Okay? I'll explain. So we create a vector of types, which doesn't make any sense, okay? But we create a vector of types. Then we call our packed triple types, packed triple function on you know, the set of types. Now the packed triple function here just sorts the types according to their alignment requirement. And we return a new type, which is the triple with the proper types in it. Is everybody kind of following here? And then, in my kind of dream syntax, we just notice that, like, I'm not creating an object here. I'm really just saying, like, this is a type, and or I should have maybe using packed equals the result of the function call. But so basically, the idea is that, like, I create a new type, which I call packed, which is the result of this function invocation here, and then I can create an object of that type, which I just computed, and I'm done. Now, obviously, to access, you know, the members of my triple in a meaningful way, that would be more job because I, you know, if I don't know which member is where, then I can't do anything useful with it. So we would have to somehow keep like an index map of where the members went. But that's completely out of scope for this talk. But basically, the idea is still that if you want to optimize your alignment, you can sort them and then, you know, optimize your instantiate your triple with the optimized order. Okay, so again, I would like to bring to your attention the fact that here, the input is known at compile time, and the output is also known at compile time. The output is a type. The input is a list of types, and the output is a type. It is you know, the triple which is the most packed. So by now, I would expect you to understand why metaprogramming could be useful in C++, just as it is useful in Python or Ruby or, you know, these languages. I don't expect you to understand, like, oh, we're going to solve our problems. Just like, can you see why it's not just something for, you know, library writers? Can you see why it's not just for, you know, people that do dark magic and stuff like that? Hopefully, you should be able to see it, or at least have a, you know, some idea of why this could be useful for you. And now, what we will try to do is design our own solution to these problems. But in order to do so, I will need to introduce something which we call tuple. Most of you might know about it, but I will still introduce it. And I believe the canonical way of introducing it is, you know, to present the returning many values from a function problem. So I'm pretty sure everybody in this room has tried at one point or the other to return many values from a function. I surely, you know, tried when I first started C++, and it's, you know, a sane thing to do. We do it in mathematics, and it just works. So here I'm, you know, just taking a 3D a 3D point in spherical coordinates, and I want to put it to Cartesian coordinates, and so it kind of makes sense to just return x, y, and z. Now, obviously, this won't work in C++, but you can use what we call a std tuple, which is basically a generalized pair. Okay, it's like a pair, except it can hold 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, any fixed and finite number of elements. Okay, so here what I do is simply return a tuple of my, you know, three coordinates. I create my tuple, and then I create, I create my x, y, and z, and then I go fetch each, you know, element in my tuple using std get. There are other ways to do it using std tie, but I'm not talking about std tie today. It's not important for me. And so this, in terms, you know, for the compiler, this is somewhat equivalent to the following code. It's a bit like, you know, creating an anonymous struct with members of the appropriate types, and then just when you use std get, you're just basically fetching the members. So in a sense, it's like a struct, yet it can be seen like a sequence because we are accessing it by index, just as we do for a vector, for a std vector. Of course, it is fixed, you know, in size, but it still has, you know, access by index, which makes it kind of interesting. And even more interesting is the fact that it can hold different types. My example using, you know, spherical coordinates used a std tuple of double, double, and double. But you can put any types there. So if I have a fish, a cat, and a dog, and I want to return all of them from a function, I can just do it, even though my fish, my cat, and my dog have nothing in common. It's obviously unrelated to like polymorphism and stuff like that. It's really just, I'm just creating an anonymous struct with members of the proper type. And so this is basically equivalent to this code here. So I expect this is not new to most people, but this is actually very, very important. Not the implementation, right? But really the fact that, you know, the types can differ, and the fact that we can see it as a sequence where the types of the elements are, you know, not all the same. So with this in mind, let's go back to class registration. What we were trying to do was, if you remember, register the classes, and we had the, you know, somewhat dumb requirement that they should all be under some size, and very important, that should be asserted statically at compile time. Now, would that work? And if not, why? I'm taking comments. I'm not asking whether that would compile. I'm asking whether this would do what we want. Yes?
No, because size of C, now you're just taking the size of the type info.
Correct.
Which tells you nothing useful about the size of the type.
Correct. So the comment is, and it's correct, that size of C here is taking the size of the std type info struct or class or whatever, instead of the size of the type that this type info represents. So it doesn't do the trick. There are other things, like the fact that you cannot put std type info in a vector because it's not copyable. But yeah, it's just a detail. But yeah, so and even if we were to add a, you know, that size method to the std type info type, it would still not do the trick. Why? the comment is that the static assert wouldn't work, and it's the right answer. It wouldn't work. Type info is something inherently runtime. It's RTTI, right? Runtime type information. When you call .size, it's something that happens all at runtime. There's no way for the compiler to know that this precise type info is, in fact, you know, representing this type here, which we know the size of at compile time. There's no way to do that. It has to go, you know, into the virtual table probably, and blah blah blah. And because when you think of it, it's there's just no way of implementing it that in differently. So we wouldn't be able to static assert on that dot size anyway. So it doesn't do the trick. So we will try to trying to work our way forward towards a solution. What if we were able to have a static type info? A type info that knows, you know, the size of the type, or even better, the type itself at compile time. So let's assume that this works, okay? So we create a vector of types, of static type infos, okay? A, B, and C. And then we for loop over that vector of types. So here, my C represents a static type info of A, of B, or of C, depending on at which index in the vector we are. Okay, this doesn't compile, but bear with me. So C here is a static type info object, okay, of some T. Well, since it's a static type info object, I can, you know, surely I can fetch this nested alias here, right? So I use decaltype. So decaltype basically, what decaltype does is just give you the type of the object, you know, that's inside the parens. So it's just, since we said that C was a static type info of something, decaltype of C is just static type info of something. And that is, you know, a C++ type, which then you can do whatever you want with. And what I'm doing with that type is, you know, fetch the nested alias called type here. Okay, and this is one of the trickiest parts of this talk. It's not too tricky, but it's like it is very important that everybody in the room understands this. Is it clear to everybody what I'm doing? So what I'm doing here is fetch, you know, the nested type alias, which is aliased to T, so that if in my loop I'm at static type info of A, then C here will be A. Because I'll be fetching the nested type inside the static type info of A, and that nested type is A.
So just to check that, what you're saying is, when we're saying decal type C there, it would be the equivalent of saying, as it iterates, it would be decal type of static type info of A.
It would just be static type info of A, okay, in the for the first pass.
And then you would get the type out of it, and then you effectively get the type as
which is A, which would be A, okay? It would be A for the first pass, so then you register A. And then for the, you know, second element in the vector, decal type of C is static type info of B. And so then you fetch the colon colon type, and that's B, and then you register B. Sorry. And then you go to static type info of C, and then same thing. So is everybody kind of clear with this? Of course, it's not possible, you know, to do that in loop and but we'll work towards something that works.
Why is it not possible, actually?
Well, okay. So the question is, why is it not possible? Well, because this here would have to change type on each iteration.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Because first, you know, the first element would be static type info of A, which is, you know, one type, and then on the second element, it would be static type info of B, which is something completely different, unrelated, so there's no possibility for anything. There was a question here.
Yeah, just because word choice, like static is going to refer to knowing compile time, right? Static type info, like out of context, it's kind of a name that means not a lot, but it's the type info that's provided by the type.
Okay, so the comment is that the word choice here might be poor because static type info is not something that conveys a lot. well, you know, you could, yeah, I kind of agree, but also kind of disagree because of, you know, static assert, and I guess, yeah, it's just a choice of words, but it's not perfect, I guess. It's what I thought about for this talk. But anyway, we'll get rid of it real soon. So, we'll get rid of it for something which is just called differently, but does the same thing. So don't celebrate too fast. Sorry. This doesn't work. We're pretty close, but what we're missing here is a vector that can really hold, you know, these static type infos of which are objects of different types, and we cannot really do that. And then we'll also need a kind of for loop that can iterate over some kind of funky vector. So if we can have a vector which can hold these static type infos of A, B, and C, we'll be pretty much in business. But hey, we just saw std tuple. And we said that std tuple was basically like a vector, except you could have elements of different types. So we kind of have our solution here, right? We can create a tuple with static type infos in there. And then we can, we're still not there, but close. We can almost iterate over a tuple. Like, if we can iterate, we're in business, can we? So, to store the type infos, you just have to use the tuple, and it's going to work. So now all we need to do is to iterate on that guy. And fortunately, you don't have to code it yourself, because there is a library that does it for you. Just as, you know, you can use std sort, because you don't want to write, you know, the std sort implementation in your own code. You definitely don't want to write the HANA for each implementation in your own code, but you surely want to use it though. So you can simply use HANA for each as if it were std for each, except it doesn't take, you know, iterators, it takes the tuple itself, and it's just going to do basically what std for each does, except on a tuple. Okay? So what happens here is that for each element in my tuple, which remember are the elements of the tuple are static type infos, okay? I'm calling this lambda here. By the way, is everybody clear on what's a generic lambda? This weird thing with an auto C in there? This is a lambda function, okay? It creates a function object. Okay, it creates a function object without me having to, you know, write it out of line. So it creates an inline function object, and the operator parens of that function object will be a template. Okay, and so the single parameter of that operator parens, okay, will be named C. So basically, what I'm doing is just creating a function object with a single parameter called C. Okay. And then I'm passing this to my HANA for each, and I know that HANA for each will take whatever, you know, tuple it is given, whatever function it is given, call the function on each element of the tuple, like this. So basically, it's basically the same as if you created, you know, so what HANA for each does is basically you create your function, and then you just call the function on each element of the tuple.
So, as a question, does that C, lowercase c, there is an instantiation of whatever type was passed in. Is it a sort of, I have a tuple of a number of types, and then C is an instance of that type for each of those member, each of the tuple
elements?
Values? Yeah, values.
So the question is, so C is basically an instance of each, of each type, you know, in the tuple. So C will be, first it will be std get of 0, so the first element of the tuple, and auto here. What the compiler will do is like see this, and then I've got a, you know, struct with a template operator parens. Okay, well, you're calling it with a static type info of A. Okay, so I'm gonna instantiate, you know, this anonymous struct operator parens with the static type info of A, and then C will be the instance of static type info of A. Yeah, that's like the technical details, but but this is how it works. But essentially, what all you have to know basically is that, you know, C here will be your static type info of whatever, okay, and and everything works out.
So I think the question was C an instance of the class, and what you're saying now is C is a type info of the class.
Well, the type was static type info. So actually, what if I gave it something that wasn't default constructed? So let's say that my types, for whatever reason, my static type info did not have a static, I just said no default initialization, I said equals delete for the default initializer of that now, just because I'm...
Okay, so the question is, what would happen if you took the static type info and just deleted its default constructor? Well, then you couldn't write this here.
Fair enough.
Like, I mean, this would still work. Well, this, you know, it's the same thing. But so this would still work because, though, if you make it, you know, non-copy constructible, then it's going to blow up because it's making a copy. But then, you know, you could be tricky and use a constref. But then the decal type would be more nasty. But anyway, so the thing is that. If you don't make it copy, default constructible, then this is going to blow up. But what you could do is just, you know, if you actually have something to initialize, you know, something runtime to initialize, fine. Just use the constructor of the tuple. I mean, it's there for something. Okay? Yes?
Is it, or I'm not familiar with HANA, but is there a requirement to pass a generic lambda to HANA for each?
So the question is it a requirement to pass a generic lambda to HANA for each? Well, no, if you have a std tuple of int, 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 you can pass a lambda which takes only int. But if you try to, you know, if you have a std tuple of fish, cat, and dog, and then you pass a lambda which takes int, the compiler will say, doesn't work like that. You know? I can compile that.
Well, you couldn't pass it your own function object though.
What?
You couldn't pass it a function object explicitly as opposed to a generic lambda.
Oh yeah. So the comment is like, or the question is, could you pass it a you know, normal function object as opposed to a generic lambda? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You can pass anything. Yeah, I mean, in the case of a, you know, if you have a std tuple of int, 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 you can even pass, you know, a function pointer. That doesn't matter. Anything that can be called. Okay. So this is equivalent to that. So just to make it clear what we're doing. Because it might seem a bit convoluted, what we're doing is we take types, we represent them as objects by using static type info. So we're kind of, you know, getting closer to the Python world here, where our types are objects. So we take types, we represent them as objects. Then, since they are just objects, they're just, you know, first class citizens of C++. So we stick them into whatever we want. In our case, we stick them in a tuple, and then, once we have a sequence of these objects, we can apply any algorithm that works on a tuple. For now, you only know about HANA for each, but there are, you know, dozens of them. So that's like the little dance. Take your objects, represent them, take your types, represent them as objects. Now you're in Python world. Yay. You can do what you want. Is everybody kind of clear with what we're doing at this point? This is like very important. If you don't get it, if you don't like, you don't have to like see very far behind what I'm trying to do, but just like if you kind of get the technique, it's good. Otherwise, I'll explain. I'm really here for that. So please raise your hand if you have any clarifications that you would like. Good, I will go on. So now HANA, and this is where we actually get rid of static type info for something exactly similar. HANA provides this static type info as HANA colon colon type. Just because it's really useful. And yeah, if you find it verbose to always create your std tuple of HANA type, HANA type, HANA type, HANA type, well, you can just use a, you know, template alias to say, actually, HANA provides something that's called HANA tuple underscore T, and then you just pass, like, say, A, B, and C, and it's going to create your tuple of types. It's just, you know, then it's just a, it's not a real limitation of the library. It's really just an sugar coating. Okay, so now I would expect you to understand the, you know, basics behind tuples, And most importantly, I would expect you to understand how and why tuples are useful for metaprogramming via the kind of technique that I've shown, that you can take your types, represent them as objects, stick them into the tuples, and then process them with algorithms. So yeah, now I'll be talking about, you know, I'll be getting deeper into what I call heterogeneous data structures and algorithms. And when I say heterogeneous, I mean basically that I mean it as opposed to homogeneous. So I just mean something that, you know, a sequence that can hold objects of different types, and an algorithm that can process such a sequence. So the first one is tuple. We already kind of, you know, saw it, but I will show more operations that we can do on a tuple. This is really like the bread and butter of metaprogramming. So from now on, I'll be using HANA tuple because, frankly, it compiles like 10 times faster. So, and yeah, it's just easier for my examples. But you can just, you know, substitute first the tuple if you prefer. So you can create a tuple using the constructor, or you can use HANA make tuple or std make tuple. Okay, both do basically the same thing. What happens here is that, you know, sometimes it's very annoying to just, if you have like 10 of them, 10 you know, different cats and elephants and who knows what, it's just annoying to repeat the types. So you'd rather like have a function that can deduce the types of the, you know, elements of the tuple that you're trying to create. So here, make tuple will just create a tuple of a cat, a dog, and a fish because that's what you're giving to it. So it's just a shortened syntax, really. There are a few differences, but nothing that's worth highlighting at this point. And so this is really equivalent to std vector in the heterogeneous world. So for metaprogramming, this is std vector. This is your best friend, really. This is the simplest and by far the most useful container. Then you can index into a tuple, just like you can index into a vector. This you cannot do with a std tuple, which is one reason why I'm using HANA here. But sorry. But you can index into a tuple just as you can index into a vector. Now, there is a small difference. Well, there are a few small differences. First, you have to give what I will call very hand-wavily a compile time number, okay? Because I don't want to get into that, because it's a beginner's talk. So basically, the underscore C here is a user-defined literal, okay? A user-defined literal is, well, just like, you know, U modifies whatever, like 0U makes it unsigned, well, underscore C will kind of will make it, you know, explicit that it is known at compile time. Like, you and I both know, you know, that zero is known at compile time. But animals, like the tuple inside the operator bracket function, it cannot really know that unless you tell it really explicitly. So this is the job of this underscore C. So I won't get into the details of compile time numbers, but most functions that expect numbers in HANA expect them to be explicitly compile time. So you will use some kind of underscore C, or there are different ways of creating them, but yeah. So you can index your tuple using compile time numbers, and depending on the index that you pick, you're going to have a different type, which is something very different from a std vector, right? And actually, the fact that you are able to retrieve elements of different types depending on the index is precisely why we need to do this underscore C thing, because basically, the type of that, okay, so the operator, I'm getting a bit too technical here, but the operator bracket that is called here is not the same operator bracket as the one that is being called here. We're using overload resolution to do some cool stuff. So anyway, this is really not important, okay? So basically, you can index just as you can index into a vector. I said too much. So now you can also insert using compile time numbers. So you can insert into a tuple, you can insert a new element at a given index. Now, this is going to give you a new tuple. This is different from, say, vector insert. And So the reason is, the reason why we must return a new tuple is because the type of the thing just changed. We cannot do it in place. We can just say like animals.insert, you know, an elephant at index one, because then, you know, animals would have to change its type to include elephant in it. So we have to create a new tuple. There's just no way of doing it. Yes?
Could the assert here be static assert?
Okay, so the question is, could the assert here be static assert? No, because we're using a string for the name. But there is a different way to do it, so that, yeah. But not getting into this one too. So yeah, we can insert stuff. And again, it gives you, you know, a new tuple. So nothing to surprising here, except the fact that that the type of the container just changed. Yes?
So if I had made a mistake and instead of inserting at one, I had inserted at two, it would catch it. The compiler catches at compile time, because then the what you're assigning it to wouldn't be correct.
So the question slash comment is that if you were inserting at two instead of one, then the compiler would catch it at compile time because the thing that you are, you know, the result of insert would be cat, dog, elephant, fish, which doesn't match, you know, the type of more animals here. That is correct. You know, I could have used auto. I specifically decided to, you know, if I had used auto, then the compiler would have just, you know, said, well, it's fine. I'm just deducing a different type for the result of this insert operation here, but I wanted to make it very obvious that I wanted to make this type here explicit so that people really understand that we are changing the type of our container by inserting a new thing in it, and we have no choice but to do that. And on, you know, a similar note, if you are trying to if you were trying to insert something at index 10, then Hana or the compiler, I think Hana would catch it in a, you know, decent way. But at the very least, the compiler would, you know, smash you in the face and tell you like this cannot possibly happen because, you know, you can't. What am I gonna fill, you know, from like tree two to nine? What am I gonna put there? Yep.
More animals at index 0, 2, and 3 still retain their value of Garfield, Beethoven, and Nemo. Have you effectively made a copy of all the values of animal and essentially made a sort of new type, copied the previous type, and inserted a new value?
So the question is, in that case here, would more animals retain the value of the elements that were not, you know, inserted? Yes, we're making a copy of the whole tuple and just adding a new element. So there are, of course, if you're, you know, if you're clever, there are cases where this can be inefficient. So you have to be careful. Like if you have like an array of 10,000 strings and you're just, you know, inserting things in your tuple, you have a tuple with like an array of 10,000 strings and then, you know, maybe some 10,001 strings, I don't know, and then you insert an array of like a std array of 10,002 strings, then you're in for some big trouble because it's going to take a long time to copy it. But you know, we're C++ programmers, so we should be able to deal with that. But yeah, we are making a copy. Yes.
And then if you change the type to auto, wouldn't the assert fail to compile?
I don't understand the question.
If you change the type of more animals to auto, then the assert below it, it's still wouldn't compile because the operator there.
Well, right now it would still compile. Right now, yeah. So the question is, would it still compile if I changed the type of more animals to auto? Yes, it would still compile. The compiler would just say, well, you know, the result of insert is tuple, ana, tuple, cat, elephant, dog, and fish, and just, you know, deduce it to be the case.
Yes, but below it, index 1c of more animals, that wouldn't be an elephant.
Oh yes, it would be an elephant. It would, yes, because yes, it would. It will just deduce that it would just be equivalent to writing this. The compiler on this line would say, well, you know, the result of insert.
I meant if you change the index. So the previous question was that when you change the index there to C, and you said that if you write auto, then it would compile.
Yeah. Okay. But this assert will fail. Yes. Okay. So yes, if I change the yes, now I understand. Yes. So if you change the type of more animal to auto, and then you change the index to 2, well, then you're going to be creating a tuple of cat, dog, elephant, and fish, and then this assert here will actually not only it will fail, but it will fail at compile time because comparing a you know, more animals of one, which would be a dog, comparing a dog to an elephant makes no sense at all. So you will get a compile time error because there is no operator equal defined on that. Okay, moving on. We can also remove stuff. Again, for the same reason, we have to create a new tuple because we're removing stuff from the container. We can iterate, like we saw. So here it's a bit different. Sorry, you were having a comment. So basically, the idea here is that we are creating a tuple with elements that have runtime values, and then we iterate over them. So, well, in this case, the cat is default constructible, but I could make it non-default constructible, and it wouldn't be a problem. Because I'm creating my tuple, then I specify the runtime values, and then I do whatever I have to do. Our use case was just our earlier use case using static type info was just a special case of this. For heterogeneous objects that have no runtime state whatsoever.
So actually, but in this example, your generic lambda takes an auto A. And is A going to actually be a copy of that type, or is it a reference to the animal's object that exists on the stack in this case?
Okay, so the question is, here I'm using auto of A, sorry, auto of A, and is A going to be a copy of the object or a reference to the element of the tuple which is on the stack? It's going to be a copy because I used auto, and this is how generic lambdas are specified, but I could use auto const ref, and then that would be a const ref to my element, or auto ref, and then that would be a ref to my element, or auto putter, and then that would be a compile time error. now I'm just trying to simplify the slides just so that they can be easier to digest. But yes, it is possible to tweak it in any number of ways for performance purposes. And I would never write that in actual code unless I know my A is always going to be trivial to copy around. But yes, this is a valid concern. So we can also do like std transform. We can take a tuple and apply a function to each element, and then create a new tuple from the result. That makes sense, sure. As long as the function is able to take any type which is in the tuple, then sure, it makes sense. So in this case, I'm taking an animal which is going to be cat, dog, and fish, depending on which element we're at. And I return its name, which is invariably going to be a std string. Now, it could be different, So I end up here with a HANA tuple of std string, because this is what I fetched inside my animals. But it could be different. I mean, I could end up with a HANA tuple of something else, and three different types depending on the kind of transformation that I did on my objects. But the point is that you can apply a function to elements of a tuple and get a tuple of the result. Just like you can with std transform. It's no different, except that std transform uses iterators to do its job, whereas HANA operates directly on the sequences, takes a sequence, returns a sequence, and is heterogeneous, which is a big difference, but still. You can filter out elements, so you can do like std remove if. So here, okay, we're getting fancy. So here, what we're doing is I want to remove everything that's a fish. Okay, so what I do is basically, well, call Hana remove if on my animals, and then the lambda here will be a predicate that will determine whether an element is to be kept in the resulting tuple or not. So if that predicate here, that generic lambda, is satisfied, then you remove the element which satisfied the predicate from the resulting tuple. I will explain the content of the predicate in a moment. But so what I end up with here, everybody understands that I'm removing things that are fishes. So I remove fishes, and I end up with a cat and a dog, because that's all I have. So here, I can assert that, indeed, my resulting tuple is just a cat and a dog. Now, what this does here, well, without getting into too much details, basically, Hana decal type underscore, and we cannot use decal type without an underscore because it's a reserved keyword. So that's why the underscore. But Hana decal type will just return a Hana colon colon type representing the type of the object that you use. OK, yes?
Just a question. So it means you cannot static assert, right, in this case? Like if it didn't make tuple, Hana doesn't match those types, so the compiler wouldn't.
So the question, the comment is here you cannot static assert. Well, no, you cannot static assert. But the reason why you cannot static assert is simply because, again, make tuple, you know, we'll have to compare cats. And cats use the string, which is not possible to compare at compile time. This is the only reason. But if you were trying to compare, say, if you were trying to, you know, compare a tuple with, I won't get into this. But yeah, OK, because I would get into some details of Hana. But so basically, OK, what this does here, decal type underscore returns a type which represents the type of the object that you passed it. Yes?
Just reflecting for that, I think that if the types, the cat, fish, and dog, will be empty types without data, string data, that static assert would work in the.
OK, so the comment is if catfish and dog were empty structs, then without members, then that would work. Well, you'd have to define what it means to compare things with no members. And then it wouldn't work as a static assert here because I didn't make that const expert. And I cannot make that const expert because I'm using a generic lambda. But now we're really getting away of ourselves. So So technically, you know, the optimizer, if you make this empty, the optimizer will just say, yeah, you know, there's nothing to compare here. But well, not if you have like 500 of them. But if you have just a few of them, the optimizer will say, easy. Okay, so anyway, the thing is, so I'm getting the type of A as an object, because we like to be in Python world, because that's easy. And then I compare it using equal equal, not to the same, equal equal, to the type of a fish. Well, to a fish, you know, to fish represented as an object. And then that's going to return a compile time boolean, which is, you know, a friend of the compile time numbers, which I won't get into. But basically, it returns a compile time boolean, which says big fat no, I am not a fish, or yes, I am a fish. And it says it explicitly enough that removeif, Hana removeif, is able to know, you know, under the hood, when it's applying like the predicate to an element, it's like, okay, you return me a big fat yes or no. Okay, I do not include this in the resulting tuple, and then it continues its job. We can get fancy. We can sort stuff. You know, if you give me a sequence of anything and give me a predicate, I don't care what it is, as long as it's like a strict weak ordering on your things, you know. As long as it kind of works, it's going to kind of work. So you can sort stuff if you give me a predicate that makes sense. So here, I'm creating a tuple. I'm creating a tuple of types, and I sort them based on their size. I'm using Hana size of underscore. Can't use Hana size of because it's reserved. I'm using Hana size of underscore to fetch a compile time number which represents the size of that thing. And then I use my less than to, you know, see which one is the smallest. And so I will be sorting my types based on their size, basically. And then I can indeed assert that my tuple is as I expect it to be. And now you should be starting to get, you know, you should be getting a bit excited because we needed to sort stuff, you know, earlier to solve our packing problem. And now we just sorted stuff. So it's cool.
Why do you need to use Hana size of underscore? Because isn't size of statically resolved anyway?
So the question is, why do I need to use Hana size of underscore as opposed to normal size of? Because isn't size of resolved statically? Yes, but size of returns a number, and I want a compile time number. That's the thing. Again, it's a bit annoying because I'm trying to make this as easy to digest as possible. And unfortunately, if I really wanted, you know, to show you the machine, it would be like 3 hours, and for like it would start like intermediate and up to expert, like really, really expert. So I really don't want to get into too much of this. And don't be scared, actually. Don't be scared. It's just because I would have to introduce like some things like the lack of context for parameters and uninteresting things like that. But yeah, so basically, it's just because I need a compile time number, which explicitly says that it is, you know, known a compile time. Yes?
Couldn't he use the size of that he's talking about if you just use it inside the template parameter on a bool?
Yeah. So yes, yeah, you could. So the comment is, couldn't you use the normal size of operator if you used it inside the template parameter of Hana bool? And yes, the answer is yes, but I haven't introduced Hana bool, and I will not, because that would mean introducing compile time booleans and compile time numbers and compile time nastiness. So so yes, it would work. But as far as, you know, you are concerned, because remember, you are all dummies, right? Because you came to this talk. So as far as you are concerned, like you want to get the size of something, Hana size of underscore is going to do the trick, you know? And then once you get more serious with the library, if you ever do, well, then you will find large amount of things that you can do differently from what I'm presenting. Yes?
Why do you need a Hana type as a type for the tuple?
Correct me if I don't repeat your question properly. So the question is, why do you need Hana type in the tuple as opposed to just Hana type? Say, here I'm using Hana type, Hana tuple, Hana type, char 1, instead of Hana tuple, char 1.
Yep.
Exactly. Okay. The thing is that these are two wildly different things. One is a tuple that contains char arrays, and the other one is a tuple that contains static type infos representing char arrays. Okay, and so this gets even more obvious if you have, for example, something like void. Can you create a tuple with void in it? No, because it doesn't make sense to have a member of a struct which is void. Right? So you have to represent the type really cleanly as an object, not as an instance of that type. This is really important.
So, well then, am I allowed to instantiate Hana tuples in my code? Could I just start using them if, how do I refer to the data members if I wanted to instantiate a Hana tuple? Or is the Hana tuple?
Oh no, you are instantiating it. I'm just saying that if you put a void in there, like if you say like Hana tuple of void, it's gonna break your, it's not gonna compile. If you say std tuple of void, it's not gonna compile either. But if you say Hana tuple of type void, then it's fine. It's just a tuple which contains a type info which represents void. So it's like a tuple which contains the type void, you know? But it doesn't really contain an instance of the type void. It contains the type itself, you know? represent it as an object, which is via our correspondence of earlier. Yes?
Another way to say it is that Hana tuple doesn't just contain Hana types, right? That's just all your examples so far have contained Hana types, so it seems useless because
the functions operate on Hana
right.
types.
So, yeah, okay. Another way to put it is that Hana tuple doesn't only contain Hana types, and indeed it's the case. It's not the case. I mean, you can put anything you want, just like std tuple. Yeah. Actually, I probably failed at this, but I tried to make it clear by using like cat, dog, and fish. Here, we're not talking about types. We're talking about things with, you know, std string and runtime values and actual. It's really like std tuple here. I'm storing actual instances, and you know the name of Garfield could be read from a file or from user input or whatever. But if I want, I can also, if it suits my use case, use Hana types. And it turns out that Hana types are default constructible, so I don't have to really, you know, initialize my tuple more than that. So is everybody following me at this point? Okay. So we can partition. instead of having a tuple where the elements that satisfy the predicate come before and then the elements that satisfy the predicate come after, instead we return a pair with two tuples. The first tuple is the things that satisfy the predicate. The second tuple contains the things that do not satisfy the predicate. So I partition on what, if you're a dog, you're going to be in the first tuple, otherwise second tuple. So I'll speed up a bit just because I want to have enough time. You can search stuff. So you can find the first element in the tuple, that satisfies some predicate. It's going to return some kind of std optional, except it's a compile time std optional. So that if you don't find it, and try to like here, okay. So I find Beethoven by searching for the first dog. Okay. I find my first dog. Here I dereference my optional, and I get my dog. Now, if I try to find int and I don't find it, if I try to dereference this thing, it's gonna, the compiler will smash me. It's not gonna be a runtime error because Hana knows that you didn't find it at compile time. So it's obviously gonna return an object that says, no, you didn't find it at compile time. So this is pretty good. It, in some cases, it can avoid runtime errors. You can count stuff. How many dogs do I have? You can reverse a tuple. And you can unpack a tuple. Unpacking a tuple is basically calling a function with the contents of a tuple. There is a function std experimental apply, which is in the library fundamentals, TS, I think. It should be added to C++. it does basically the same thing as Hana unpack, except the arguments are reversed. And so what you can do is you create your tuple, and then you can call a function with the contents of the tuple. And so what's going to happen is basically if you have your function, and I use a generic lambda just because I don't want to have to define a function object out of line, but it's the same. It's just like calling your function with each element. That's it. And it's very, very useful. OK. So now let's go back to alignment optimization. We wanted to find the most packed triple. It could be a tuple, actually. We could generalize it to tuple anytime. It's just because I hadn't introduced tuple at this part of the talk. But keep in mind that this could be a tuple for what it's worth. And so the solution, obviously, is to use a tuple to sort the types, that is. So we're going to, sort these guys in order of decreasing alignment. And then we're going to create the new type, the type which is a triple, which is the most packed. And to do this, we will put our types that we want to sort into a tuple, okay, because we want to represent our types as objects. And then we will use our cute algorithm on tuple sort to sort the tuple based on their alignment. Notice that I am sorting in decreasing order. So aling of underscore, which cannot be alignov for obvious reasons, does the same as size of, which does the same as all these guys, returns the alignov as a compiled lambda number again. And so I can sort my types based on their alignment. And then, so this is a tuple that contains the types, and again, not instances of these types, but the types themselves, because we're in Python land. We're representing types as objects here. So I have a sorted tuple which contains the types, you know, in the best possible order. And then here's the slightly trickier part. So I take my sorted types, and then I unpack them into this function. And then I create my triple, which is the answer that I'm looking for. And the way that I do it, here, dot, 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 t, this is a parameter pack, okay? And these, each t in the pack is going to be a static type info, right? It's going to be a HANA type. So this guy has a nested alias named type, right? Which I can access using decal type, colon, colon, type. Okay, and then I expand this. So I expand the type which is represented, you know, which is represented as a static type info object. I expand it inside my parameter list of triple. Is it clear to everybody? I know this might be like, especially if you are not too familiar with how variadic expansion works. I know this can be maybe a bit challenging, but is it like, anybody needs more clarifications about this particular line? Okay. Oh, yes, go ahead.
So this, unpack will take all of the values of sorted, and so unlike sort of the for each example where the generic lambda was being called for each
element of the tuple,
this is sort of giving
all of
it's
it.
It's a giant sort of variable argument that you end up with this parameter pack.
As a parameter pack, yeah.
So then your following operations are dealing with it as a parameter pack and doing other things on the parameter pack.
Yeah. Just because it's useful here to use parameter pack expansion to do what I have to do.
And the triple there was the earlier triple we had seen at the very beginning, which
only three elements, but it could be generalized to anything, you know, to tuple if I had introduced it at that time. So now that I know my triple, which is hopefully going to be the most packed way of you know, declaring my triple, then I wrap this answer again into my static type info because I need to return it somehow, and we cannot return types from function. So I return my type object from my function, and then I return. So unpack here, we'll call this function. So triple will end up being HANA type answer. Is everybody following me? And so I return this triple. So I return here packed triple. When I call it with my types, basically I have a static type info which contains the triple with the proper you know, types in it in the proper order that I was looking for. Yes.
So that you have a function here that doesn't actually run.
Oh yeah,
it doesn't run. It runs at runtime. It is your decal type is sort of running through that function and returns a type.
Yes.
It doesn't matter what the values are that is returned. It's really then you're just extracting the type of the result.
Yes, it is.
To be used as a using, and then you actually use it later. Okay.
Yes. Well, you just understood HANA.
Yeah.
So the comment is, with you know bewildered eyes. That basically I'm never running this packed triple function. You're only ever calling decal type on it, and then you know using it to you know for the compiler to run through this and you know deduce sorted what is sorted and then what is triple and then return this and then okay I know decal type now I can fetch what's in there. Yes, that's the so the insight you know that led to the development of HANA was this. Was that you could use auto and generic lambdas and you know auto deduce return type to make the compiler work for you in a heterogeneous setting. Yes?
How you initialize that triple object?
Because you just lose the information that what are the order of the fields.
Yes. So the comment is, how can you initialize the triple object because you just lost the information of the order of the things? Yes. As I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, in order for this to be really useful, we would have to keep this. You know, we would have to do some additional bookkeeping. It's not terribly difficult. We could create a tuple of pairs where one. The first element is an index. The second element is a type. Then when I sort here, I sort on the alignment of each second element of my pair, which is going to be the the type. But then I'm going to get a tuple of index sorted pairs with indices and types. But it's just to simplify things. But that would be possible, definitely. In the library implementation, that's how I would do it. Okay, and so I call decal type of my pack triple. This deduces the type of my thing of my return type here. And since this is a static type info which contains my answer, I can again just fetch the colon type, and then we're done. So is everybody kind of clear with what we are doing here? Good. So this really is like. Now, there are ways to make it more terse, but this really is the insight behind HANA. If you want to use it, write functions. Not write meta functions, write functions. And then, when you're done, you get the types back. I think there was a question at the back. OK, move on. So there is a way to write this in more terse manner, just because I can already see like the tractor saying, yeah, but if you do this with MPL, it's going to be easier. Yeah, but you can also do it differently. Okay, so moving on. We sell tuples. I don't want to present this because it's really not important. It's just like basically just to feel good for myself, just to convince me that you don't have to be super verbose. So we sell tuples. Now I would like to present another heterogeneous container which is very useful. It's the map. It's a heterogeneous map. So it's a bit like stood an ordered map. It is an ordered. It uses the implementation uses a hash kind of thing. Actually, Jason Rice here is, in big part the author of this map. He had a great idea which actually optimized the storage. And anyway, great thing. But so basically, it's a map where the keys can be whatever you want, whatever types you want, and the values can be whatever types you want too. So here, the values are, of different types, and the keys here, technically, they are of different types. So what is this? This is a compile time string. So after compile time number, compile time boolean, compile time whatever, compile time string. You can create a compile time string using underscore s. This is a non-standard extension supported by Clang and GCC. Unfortunately, it didn't get in C++ 14. I do not think it will get in C++ 17. But in C++ 20, probably. So anyway, Anna is only works on Clang and GCC, so it's not really an issue. So this creates a compile time string. So here I'm mapping strings to whatever I want. Oh, I am kind of late though. So we can access things by using the bracket operator, just like you can for an ordered map. Right, but again, the values don't necessarily have to be of the same types. You can query whether something is contained inside a map. And now, interesting thing, this is a static assert here. The map knows what it contains at compile time, right? As long as you know the name of what you're looking for at compile time, conceptually, there is no reason why we shouldn't be able to give you the result, the answer, whether it is in the map or not, at compile time. And indeed, it is given to you at compile time in the form of a compile time boolean, which converts implicitly to a normal boolean, which is why the static assert function works here. You can insert stuff just like you could for the tuple, except you insert it by key. And you can also remove stuff. And now, a small example, which I actually took from Michael Case, his talk on fusion of a couple of years back. So the goal is to create an event system. Basically, I have some events. I know all of them at compile time. And I also know, I always know what event I want to trigger at compile time. This is, you know, this is not necessarily applicable to all situations, but in the case where this is your, you know, if this is your use case, if you always know the events at compile time, well, it can be nice to have some guarantees like that if you are trying to trigger an event that doesn't exist, you would like the compiler to smash you. And if you try to add a handler to an event that doesn't exist, you want the compiler to tell you uh-uh. And if you want to trigger an event that doesn't exist, same thing. So, okay. To implement this, what we're going to do is, well, create make event system. So basically, what we want here is basically like the event system is kind of a map from compile time strings to, you know, many handlers, right? Because we can attach many handlers to each event. So this is kind of a map from compile time string to std vector of function. So this is what we do here. Our callbacks is a std vector of std function of void. And then we create a map, you know, mapping the events to the callbacks. And then we just create the event system. Now let me show you how the event system looks. It holds the map, you know, as a member. So it actually holds a compile time map, which takes compile time strings to vectors of functions. Everybody's with me at this point? Okay. And when you create it, it's just default constructed, so all the std vectors are empty. So you have no handlers attached to each event. And then when you want to attach a handler to an event, well, you pass in an event, which is a compile time string, and a function. And then, so, okay, first, if you don't know about the event, then you want a static assert. And then you go fetch the vector associated to that event, you know, the vector of callbacks associated to that event, and then you just push back the new event into the new handler into it. And then when you want to trigger one or more events, well, you just, you know, for each event that you gave me, I'm just going to make sure that I know it, otherwise I'll smash you, and then I'll call all the handlers associated to that event. Pretty simple. And it turns out that it works. So there are many applications. We just scratched the surface, really. Okay, and this is a beginner's talk. But like we saw JSON, well, kind of, yeah, so we saw the application. We didn't see how to actually do it. But it's possible and even not that hard. We saw class registration, optimizations, event system, but there are, you know, like many of them. This is even just scratching the surface. Dimensional analysis, where you have quantities with, you know, like types associated to them, and like kilogram. You don't want to, you know, add a kilogram and a millimeter because it doesn't make any sense. You want to be able to catch that at compile time. Well, metaprogramming can be useful for that. Serialization, we saw JSON, but there, you know, it could be just like straight on the wire or something else. Automatic parallelization. This is actually something very, very interesting. You create a compile time graph because we can do whatever we want at compile time. So we create a compile time graph which represents, you know, your call graph. And then if you specify your dependencies between your computations, well, I can walk that graph and just, you know, run everything I want, that as long as I satisfy the dependencies, right? I can run everything I want in parallel. And then you can tweak whatever you want, you know, with policies and, yeah, whatever. But I mean, this is super powerful. We can build very powerful domain-specific languages with that. And actually, this is my next point, the main specific languages. And expression templates, which are basically the tool for the main specific languages. So, you know, applications are, there are many of them. So HANA is in Boost. It will be released with Boost 1.6.1, which is underway. I mean, it should be out pretty soon. So use it if you want. Help us improve it, because you know it's basically it's a new library. It uses a lot of new features in the language. It uses a completely different way of doing metaprogramming. It's, you know, never been done before, really. So we will find some problems. We will definitely find a lot of problems, but we will solve them, and we will get to a point where the expressivity that you were able to witness today, you know, of writing actual generic lambdas. We weren't, you know, using MPL lambda expressions and then colon type everywhere. We had a few of them, but nothing compared to the mess that we had 10 years ago. So we will eventually get, I think, we will get to a point where this kind of level of expressiveness, of Pythonicity, if you will, is actually, you know, efficient both at runtime and at compile time, and usable by everybody. This is my goal. And my goal, in the very long term, eventually, is to make this part of the standard, because it is useful. So when we have, 10 years from now, if I'm still, you know, around, 10 years from now, when we have a very good solution, we will eventually want metaprogramming to be expressive and in the standard, because it is useful. It is useful in Ruby, in Python. No reason why it couldn't be useful in C++. Thank you so much.